Hi everyone and welcome to the channel. If you have one of these, a Logitech G502 Hero high performance wired gaming mouse, and it's developed a nasty habit of double clicking or worse yet, releasing clicks mid drag, stick around and I'll show you step by step how I fixed mine by replacing some 100 year old tech that makes this unit tick. I know, I'm not a writer. Okay, let's see what we got here. The weight's out. Okay, here's what I'm thinking. There's little notches here to get something under there and peel these off. When they're one here, that means that these little skids or skates or whatever they are replaceable. So when I peel these off and they no longer stick anymore, I should hopefully be able to get some replacements. What about this guy? Pretty sticky. I probably should have taken this one first. This worked pretty well. This one's a little less well attached. Okay, there's two tiny little screws under here. Okay, there was a small clip here, came off pretty easily. There aren't any in the back. Yeah, there's like a Delrin. I don't think it's PTFE or nylon. Could be nylon. It's not super durable. It's really easy to deform and it's not that thick. It's probably about a half a millimeter, maybe less. So if you're trying this yourself, all of the feet need to come off except for the one on the cover, which since I have to buy a new set, I'll replace that one anyway. Right in there, there's a black clip. There's one on the other side. So if we're lucky, this will just slide out of there, slide off the front. What if we push it? Yep, they don't really want you in here. Oh, that side came off. And you just gotta keep rocking it down. Okay, so you can see the switches. You look here, so these blue ones are gonna be the main ones. And you can see the number on that one, D2FC. The C denotes China. Okay, real quick, before we get carried away here, I want to show you where the clips are. So on the bottom, we've got two screws come out, the bottom pulls away. There is one tab right here, there's a little tab. And these, the front two, have a little lip underneath of them. So they kind of curl over the counterpart on here. And that's pretty much it. Here's the counterpart to the one on the bottom, right here. Anywhere you can get a tool in there, make sure to use a plastic one. In order to desolder the switches, we need to get to the bottom of that. So we got to get all the way in here. So there's two ribbon cables, this little white one here on this little daughter board. It's got these side switches on it. And then this one here that goes down underneath. And then you've got this little multi-pin Molex connector, all pretty straightforward. If you look here, this little black part is a keeper. You just pop that up and it stops. It's got a little pin in there and that releases the locking tension on this ribbon cable. And now you can just gently pull it out straight up. In this daughter board, we will also take off, lift up each side equally. Sometimes they're a little tough. So that little daughter board is off of there and out of the way. Now we need to take this connector off. And these just plug in. Normally you can just push on the edges of this connector and they'll release carefully because you don't want to pull this soldered on connector off of the circuit board. There we go. And these only go one way. All right, now we need to get into the wheel. It's just got a little axle or a pivot, a little pin held that whole thing in there. Since this button has got pressure that kicks it back up, there's going to be a spring under here somewhere. So it looks like this just lifts out. An assembly. Okay, that's cool. All right, right here. See the switch in the front? This little copper deal. Right next to that. See the teeny little spring? Teeny little spring? Don't lose those. You will never find them again and it will never work right. That tiny little spring. We've got one screw here, two screws here, two screws in the front. Let's start back here. If you're not sure, take pictures. You'll thank me later. So we'll get a better look at these part numbers in a minute. Compare them to the new Japanese-made switches. Don't look like they're catching much. Because they're the same length, which is good for putting them back together if they're all the same. Haven't really looked at them yet. So that should be everything. Yep, no clips or anything. And this is what we need. We just need these two. Three pins here and these three here. Here's the new switches I got from Amazon because they were cheaper than getting them shipped from DigiKey, which is where I'd normally source stuff like this. They look legit. I'm hoping that I'm not replacing crappy Chinese Omron switches with counterfeit Japanese Omron switches. It's focusing or not. Get the gray actuator, which I believe is 20 million, but it says Omron Japan. I'm not sure if you can pick that up either. So that's the new one. So I got four of them for about $9. Our two switches are the two here. They have larger pins than the other ones, so they're easy to identify, so we don't have to worry about getting the wrong thing. What I like to do is use one of these things, the ubiquitous solder sucker, which is an awkward, weird thing, but it works fairly well. You want to make sure you got some solder on your tip, get it tinned up a little bit. And I'm going to start on one of these inside ones. You just get it hot till the solder melts. The goal here is not to get it completely spotless. It's better to use some flux, but I don't have any currently. Okay, those are fairly good. We're gonna follow this up with some solder wick. So we just wanna get the bulk of this off. Now, some guys will use just solder wick. And desoldering is universally always a pain in the butt. Now we're gonna use this stuff, which is a braided copper material. So what you do is you just tuck this in, get a good thermal contact with your pin, kind of work it around. You can see that it's wicked up some solder on there. And this stuff will get hot. It's a really good conductor of heat and electricity. So it's sort of a balancing act between keeping enough solder on there to wet it. Because when you don't have any flux and you don't have much solder, you're not getting good thermal contact and it doesn't do anything and it's frustrating. And you don't want to linger too much. Okay, so now that we've got most of the solder off, what we're going to do is we're going to try to heat these and get them all heated up at the same time. Just want to kind of keep moving down the line. And I'm just going to use these little pliers to kind of wiggle it. To heat these up, a little downward pressure on it. You also need to be careful of these solder pads because that's the one thing you don't want to damage. There we go. You can see switch. Get over here. This one, we don't have as much room. Keep it moving so it can't re-solder itself. It makes it much easier. But at the same time, being careful not to pull those solder pads off because then you'll be repairing this stuff in the way. Oh, just grenaded that switch. Let's get a little more solder off of these solder pads. So that should do us for those. We'll do a little prep work on here, clean this up a little bit, get the new switches ready. Just getting these finished up here. I use these alcohol prep pads. They're pretty cheap. Okay, so we're looking pretty good. Solder pads are still in good shape. One of the reasons you want to avoid a lot of heat is these pads will actually pull away from here. And once they do that, it just would flop around. So you're not going to get a reliable mechanical connection unless you super glue it or something on there. New switches are here. 01F, 75 gram, made in Japan. So if you look at the board, you forgot which way the switches went in. This square pad denotes the end with the actuator. I like to get them tinned up a little bit, clean the gunk off, and then put some good tin on there. So I'm just going to hold this in place, put my iron on there, and hopefully there will be enough solder to stick it. And there is. Now when I apply more, I'll kind of hold my tip on there, hold the pin in place so it doesn't slide out. Get a decent blob of solder. You just want to cover the pad, get it nice and hot, and then hold it in place until you see that solder flash off. You'll usually see it kind of cool. The puddle cools kind of all at once, and then when you're finished, it should be nice and solid. So I'm going to go the extra step here and make sure that the switch is seated. Since this is a mouse, it's going to be critical where the pad is positioned, and you want to do this before you solder the other two pins. Verify pin direction, make sure the plunger is on the outside. And this all seems really easy and straightforward, right up until you screw it up, because everybody does. And this one, I'm just re-wetting the solder. Make sure it's seated. Those little pieces of loose solder can come back to bite you and get underneath something, or short two pins together, or short across one of these tiny little SMDs. So now we're going to do a quick look. Make sure our switches are flush, and they are. You can see here, flush to the board, flush to the board. Now that that one's solid and solidified, you can just rock on the other two. And for heat conduction, you want to make sure that your iron is tinned. Hold it on the pad and the terminal. Push your solder in there until it forms this little dome. Come back to this one. You don't have to tin your tip every time. Okay, so now we're done. She's all back together. Board's all cleaned up. All right, so here we go. Back to this. Just put back into place. Now we got this little standoff. Goes like this. The back of that. Screws in here. These little screws, if your screwdriver tip isn't magnetic, at least a little bit, might be a good idea to magnetize it. Makes it a lot easier to manipulate these little screws. There's 5 screws that hold the board on. Go ahead and snug them up so they're all in there. Not too tight, not too loose. The 2 little pockets up here are for those springs. And another little container somewhere in there. I wouldn't lose them, which I still might. So that's going to go in here. I'm going to go ahead and do these first. Make sure these little clips are lifted up before you slide them in. And I usually just use my fingers, give it a little tug. So make sure you pop those out and seat them back down when you're done. Make sure they're all the way in there. Do this little Molex connector last. These are keyed. Springs, not my favorite. There's one, and even a little bit of magnetism will cause you some grief here. Be very careful with these. So they're both in there. Now, do anything else until you get that together. Go ahead and set that front end of this down in there first on the springs. Slide it back a little. This little axle slides in with this little foot facing down. That goes like that. Comes in from this side, left side. Hold this out of the way. And it kind of snaps in place. Make sure that daughter card's back in its slot. And that's that. Hopefully, we'll just be able to put these together. Bosses went down, and you can see we're very close on the pin area. So hopefully, push that down on there, snap it in place. Seems to be the case. Now there's one on the side over here. Verify that all the buttons are clicking. Means the daughter card stayed in place. Left click, right click. Slightly more pressure, so we're good. We're all back together. Put the 4 screws in. We will need to reinstall new skates. Those of you that are contemplating this repair and you're hoping to cheap out and not spend the $6 to $10 or whatever for a new set of skates, don't bother, because by the time you get them off and get them in a place where they're not going to stick to something and think you're going to reinstall them, you're probably not. I got this mouse skates, comes with a little tweezer. I haven't opened the inner packet yet. I'm not necessarily recommending this one. Originally, I was going to get the cheapest one I could find, which was the same brand, I believe. Let's go ahead and open this up. Interesting. It's a sealed packet, foil, so it's preserving something. Oh, it's got cleaner, which I assume is just like my alcohol pads. One of these, it's not really, I don't know what I'd want it for a mouse. So here's the actual feet. You can see those. They feel pretty good. The really cheap ones had round or had square corners, and some of the reviews complained about the corners catching on stuff. So rather than buy $6 worth of skates and spending $20 worth of my time trying to round off the corners, I just went ahead and opted for the extra $3 or $4 and got the better ones. I don't know what this is. Colorful mouse grip tape. No thanks. So there we go. That's what we got left. And then we'll be buttoning this baby back up and we'll be good to go. Clean this up. I'm gonna use one of their special mouse cleaner pads, which I'm pretty sure is just gonna be alcohol. Most of these are pretty clean. I'm pretty careful and I peeled them off. I'm using the plastic tweezers that they gave me because I'm not gonna use them to install them. This one's got a little more on it. Yeah, I strongly recommend that you test it before you put the feet on. Pretty sure the Amazon page said that they have 3M adhesive, which, can you really believe anything they say anymore? Let's start with these inner ones. I'm going to use this guy. Look at these come off. Come off of there really good. That's what the adhesive looks like. Yeah, I'm going to go for the point instead of the end. I didn't like these were white at first. But now it's sort of growing on me because the whole theme of the SE mouse is the white on black. So kind of digging it now. Yeah, that one's pretty good. The fit's good. They seem thick enough. Yeah, I think the center point's the way to go because these end ones don't really have a little barrier wall like the other ones do. I'll give this a good mash when I get done with it. Let's do this little one next. Yeah, the fit's good. They're nicely die cut. The long back one here. This one's going to be a little more awkward, I think. They're pretty good fit. This one's a little odd on that corner. It's a larger one. We'll get the center point in there first. Two angles. I'm trying to do this so you can see what I'm doing and I can see what I'm doing. That one's pretty good. Fits pretty good. I can't really complain. They are slippery. It's supposed to be PTFE. It's a Teflon material. Got one more to do. Something to hold it. We shall see. All right. That's it. She is done. For me, it was well worth it. I enjoy doing things like this, and I'm cheap. I don't like spending a lot of money. The skids, the switches were $8 and something. These were roughly 10 bucks. But, you know, I like everything else about it. I'm not disappointed I got it. I especially like that I can decouple the scroll wheel and scroll like a boss across my 800 open browser tabs. Why bookmark something when you can just leave it open forever? So anyways, I hope you decide to take this project on for yourself and that you're successful as I was. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it.